Hello, and welcome to Turtle Power Pod, the podcast where we watch every episode of the classic 1987 Ninja Turtle cartoon and then give you a breakdown. My guest today is Natalie.
Yo, yo, yo.
And also with me today is a very special guest, Hungover Cranston.
Good morning, all you people out there. Well, I hope everyone's having a good morning.
Everyone is. How are you? How's your morning going?
If you're not listening in the morning, well, I guess it doesn't pertain to you.
Do you have a message for people who aren't listening in the morning?
Have a great rest of your day.
Oh, it was really nice.
Yeah.
It's all my fault. I turned 30 yesterday.
You bitch.
I turned 30 yesterday.
You're going to need to look at the microphone when
okay,
you speak.
Okay, I know. I'm sorry.
Don't look at Cranston. Don't look at him.
You could look at me, but don't speak
to him.
Do not.
Don't you think about
it. Do not speak.
Well, yeah.
So tell us how your birthday went.
It was great. Dressed up like a pirate.
Yeah, you did. We went to a bar called Jolly Rogers.
Jolly Roger.
Jolly Roger. And I ate a plate of mac and cheese and a triple burger.
Yeah. Honestly, I was a little jealous when I saw it.
It was a triple burger?
Yeah, there was three patties.
Jesus, man.
It was pretty great.
3/8 of a pound.
Yeah. It's not like... But I mean, that's still more than a quarter pound of meat.
No, it's a good... And the mac and cheese on top of that.
Yes. Was your sister super drunk?
Yes.
Because she didn't seem like she was that drunk. And then at the end of the night, she was like slurring and moving like this.
Oh, yeah. The Hakenins are creepers in the way that like you don't realize that we're drunk until we're really drunk.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden it's like, whoa. I don't know.
That's the opposite of my girlfriend. Because even when she's not drunk, one drink in and she seems like off her rocker.
Like it's spring break.
Yeah.
Sorry, well, Casey.
No. I mean, she's a cheap date.
She was having so much fun and I love her so much. And I this isn't a bad thing.
No, I was so happy to see her. And
she had a lot of fun. But the only thing is you got to repeat everything to her a million times. How many times did she ask me if we closed our tab?
I
like 18 times.
I wasn't a witness to that. So I don't.
I didn't see that part either.
All right.
As far as... So I don't want to say Natalie's sister's name because I feel like she didn't give us permission. So
Natalie's sister, Natalie's sister.
Can I talk, please? If I'm going to give her like shit about being drunk and talking about her personal life, I don't feel it's fair for me to name her unless she like told us that was cool. With Casey, on the other hand, I've already mentioned her so many times.
At this point, there's
at
no
At this point, yeah, she had her time to like, I don't know, file her grievances.
Yeah.
And it's too late. Sorry, Casey.
Cool.
That's all right.
Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle.
Oh, yeah?
What the fuck?
I don't know, man.
She's grunt singing.
You don't have to fill in every moment with sounds.
I'm sorry. Just
Cranston.
Really punchy. What?
You got drunk.
Yes.
And you seem grumpy today.
I am running on fumes. I don't think I'm grumpy. I think I'm irritable.
Yeah, well.
They're similar.
But when you are irritated, because you are irritable,
yeah.
It becomes grumpy.
It comes off as grumpy.
Yeah, no, it is grumpy.
I got 4.5 hours of sleep.
Good.
Sounds about right.
That's not enough.
Do you know what Casey had for dinner after we left the bar?
Protein.
We went to Taco Bell because you heard her ask for that.
Yeah.
And well, it's also a classic.
Yeah.
She got 3 Supreme tacos, a Crunchwrap Supreme, and Supreme nachos.
Oh my goodness.
Supreme. She ate them all.
A supreme dream.
That sounds so
a dream of
good
supreme.
Right.
Are you also hungover?
Yeah.
I'm the only one that's not because I didn't drink. I had one shot with you early in the day.
Yeah, you had a few drinks, and then you ducked out at a reasonable time.
Yeah, I had no. I had one drink, and I ducked out at a reasonable time.
I asked Natalie, I'm like, okay, really excited to hang out with your friends. This is great. Your friends are cool. And they were, for the most part.
Yeah.
And
especially the handsy guy.
Who?
I don't know his last name, so I guess it doesn't matter. Andrew?
Oh,
yeah, he's awesome.
Yeah, he's great.
He's just, yes, one of my favorites. Very loving. He's
So,
he's teddy bear.
We had kind of talked about it, and I'm like, what in your mind like is how late we're going to stay out? And we kind of agreed that like midnight, 1 o'clock, that's probably a good time.
But then your sister's like, I live 2 blocks from here, we should go.
No, we went, so we already had an after party planned.
Yeah.
We did not go to Melissa's house.
Okay.
No. We went to, whose house was it? Anyway, we don't need to say their names. We went to two friends' house and kept going.
Yep.
I did not realize she was continuing to have more beer.
I
long story short, we got home after 3.
Congratulations.
So that is why I'm tired.
And this is your 30th birthday. So happy birthday on air. Yes.
Well, I mean, it was yesterday, but thank you.
And also, I mean, or this is the last good year you're going to have. So.
Yeah, I mean, it's just all downhill from here. So my first note.
No, hold on.
You're not done with me yet.
Well, we'll start. But I have a note about the intro.
Another note.
A note about the intro that I haven't had. We haven't had any notes about the intro in a long, long time.
We talked about the intro last show.
Well, Natalie did, but...
Okay, fine.
Anyway.
Any whoozle.
Doesn't count.
The pros haven't talked about the intro for a long, long time.
And by pros, we mean the people who pay for this shit.
Oh. There's a part where Donatello backflips on the glider.
Yeah.
You know? And it's like, it's just a cool little shot of him. But when he... When it shows his face, for a second, you see him have this, like, intense glare... Like he's in the middle of a dog fight. But I'm like, but they make it look playful, and then it shows his face, and he's like, ah, oh, fuck, this shit's real. I just thought that was weird that they would do that. It's not a very important note.
Especially when I think flips, I think Raphael.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he's just the flip master.
He flips on everything. Flips is it Leonardo?
In this one, on the glider, it's Donatello.
Oh, okay. But I do not recall.
Yeah, I don't know. It's a quick shot. You want to see it real quick?
Sure. Oh, he does like a loop-de-loop.
He does a loop-de-loop, and it's like playful, and the music is, you know, the music.
I don't think it's playful. I think they're actually showing like a real fight.
But there's nothing happening. It's just him flying through the air.
Well, yeah, but you can't see the enemy in front of him or possibly behind him. I think that's an evasive maneuver.
All right, that's fair.
Are you saying that's out of character for Donatello?
No, I'm just saying that it's.
He was saying that it looked playful.
Oh, but his face is like. Ugh,
yeah.
Yeah.
I don't think
it was playful. Personally.
All right, that's fair.
I think Mikey. Now Mikey's.
They all have
Mikey's
some pretty good battle faces on.
Oh yeah. Now,
Mikey's battle is him fucking dance battling.
Yeah, exactly. Well, no, he has the part where he's chucking everything away. Nunchucking things out of his way.
Can you imagine if in the world, instead of war, you had dance battles? Like, it was just a regular, everybody took it for granted.
So it's like trial by combat, and people would pick their representative
exactly.
to dance battle?
Oh, yeah, or like groups.
Here's why that wouldn't work.
A team.
Because I would become the strongest person alive.
What?
Because during every dance battle, I would just walk up and stab everybody.
Oh, shit.
And people will be like, we don't know how to defend against it. All we know is the dance.
No, it's not like...
Robot out of the way.
It's not like we don't have weapons. I'm just saying this was...
Yeah, but that's why it wouldn't work. If weapons are the option, no one would go for the dance
route.
No,
because
why not?
It's tradition. And if you did that, if you went up and stabbed one of the dancers, you'd be fucking sentenced to life in prison.
Well, they can try to dance me into prison, but I'll stab them too.
Well, no... No,
well, that's no different
not,
than what it is now.
We
it's
need
not
we
like everyone
someone.
Has to dance in this reality.
Well, yeah, but when it's
what? Wait, what?
When it's war,
level,
it's fine, right?
What conflict level can be resolved by dancing? That stabbing because there's stabbings now, and you still go to prison.
What's the difference? If we're talking about like who gets the last slice of pizza and we dance battle, who the fuck cares? Like,
okay.
Why are we even talking about that?
That's like saying
I'm talking about serious shit.
Rock, paper, scissors.
Like we're gonna take your country. Uh-huh. No, you're not gonna take our country.
Yeah.
Okay.
Dance battle.
Yeah.
And then
we need is one person. It doesn't have to be any one person that decides they'd rather stab than dance, and that country wins.
So you'd assassinate people?
No, but then
like
it wouldn't
during
count.
The dance battle?
That's what I'm saying. If you just went up and stabbed him, they'd be like, oh, guys, we gotta get another dancer,
yeah,
start
they
over.
They could get another dancer, and then I fucking stab him.
No, you'd be in jail.
They can't. They can't.
They would take
away. If all resolutions are solved by dance, when
no,
I'm
no,
in
no,
court
no, no, no.
and they're trying to convict me, and the judge starts doing a little ditty, I go up and I stab him.
No, in this reality, everything is exactly the same as this reality, except wars between nations have been replaced with dance battles.
It wouldn't work.
But when one person doesn't like the outcome of that dance battle, regardless of stabbing in the middle of it,
yeah,
they would resort to violence again.
If there's
they'd be like, no, I don't fucking like that decision.
If there's any hint of violence, the dancing is out the window immediately.
Yeah.
Nobody cares what your tradition is.
I like that the idea is that you're assassinating people by stabbing them in the middle of the dance battle.
I said my hypothetical. I didn't necessarily mean that I'm the one stabbing. I just meant as an example.
Yeah.
One person that decides that this tradition is stupid.
Yeah.
And the whole tradition is out the window.
Okay.
Because now it's like, we're either going to dance battle or someone's going to stab me halfway through.
What I like to
I'm not
going to
dance. I'm just going to start protecting myself.
Damn it, Cranston. One second. I like the idea of Natalie's weird hippie world.
I didn't say I don't like the idea.
No,
it's an alternate universe.
But listen, what if instead of assassinating people with like a knife, like in Natalie's world, you could go up behind someone and start dancing behind them.
And that would like
And they'd
hurt
be like,
them.
Oh no, I lost! Out of whatever.
Would they just
or
disappear?
I don't know.
They would just turn
here's
into,
what I would
turn
like
into
to
glitter
make
it. Blow away.
If we're going to do this, I think that
if we're going to
if in this alternate
this
reality
into the union.
For in my mind for this to work,
yeah.
There's some sort of magic or power that dancing harms people.
See, but then you just need to turn it violent again?
Yes.
No. Being a better dancer is the utmost respect that you can have. And being a lesser dancer magically makes you succumb to the will of the other.
I've got one more point to make, and then I'll let it lie.
Okay.
It's kind of a two-part one point.
I'll allow
have
it.
Have you seen the movie The Invention of Lying?
Yes.
That world...
I love it.
Yeah, it's great. In that world, nobody lies.
Nobody knows what lying is.
It's just not a thing.
Yeah.
And that works great. I'm going to say that lying in this movie is like dancing in this world.
Okay.
So it works until one person fucks it up. Because it only takes one person to bring that out. If all of a sudden one person can lie or one person solves his conflicts with violence.
Yeah.
Then... nobody can trust anybody anymore. Do you get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
If one person has a gun and everyone else is just dancing, he cannot be stopped.
I guess
if he decides not to live in the confines of that rule. So if we can have this so it's a perfect world where no one is fucking different, everyone's the same. Fucking communist.
What the fuck is that?
It has nothing to do with people being the same.
No, okay.
Yeah,
and,
everyone's
okay.
fine. Everyone's cool in their bubble
shut
world.
Up. Everyone shut up for a second.
Okay.
I don't understand reality.
I think, shut. Old man Jansen. I feel like in this world, for this to be reality, I think like violence is super abhorrent. Like if you tried to hurt someone, you'd vomit.
Sure, but there'd still be sociopaths.
Sure.
And psychopaths.
Right. But they do everything they can to avoid violence.
All you need is one.
No, but...
to stab at you.
Yeah, you just get one guy.
All you need is one.
And it
crumbles. Yeah, but there's still law and order. There's still, like...
Why?
Death.
Why? All right. Anarchy!
Well, we have law and order, but
people
still stab.
Dance anarchy!
I guess... I guess ultimately, I'm not making another point.
Could you put
I'm,
some sick beats under that?
No.
I'm not making another yeah, point. Okay. I'm just rounding out my point. Is that dancing's great, mm-hmm. but if you're worried that someone could stab you,
You'll stop dancing
oh, and shit. Protect yourself right. from
is
being
that the
stabbed.
Plot of
that's
that?
A fair point.
That's my opinion. If you guys have an opinion, I'm curious what you think.
Is that the plot of Flashdance?
If you're right and agree with me, or if yes. you're wrong and agree with them somehow, that's great.
Like, comment, and subscribe.
Like, comment, subscribe.
All right.
Perfect.
Send us things.
Well, we are today on season 3.
Episode 6.
No, I get to do the episode because you get to do the intro. You're doing my thing.
Fine.
Episode fine. Season 3. Episode 6. The old switcheroo.
Huzzah!
I know we never actually said that rule, but I feel like that's how it's been going. So I look forward to being able to do the episode name.
Okay.
It was good. It was really good.
You did okay.
I feel like when I say the episode name is when we start getting back to turtles. Because we always have our initial, like, we're kind of moving yeah. away.
Hubbly
yeah.
bubbly.
Hubbly, yeah.
And now we're done with the hubbly bubbly.
We tabled that. We tabled the dance world. Dance anarchy world.
And we go into the turtle world. And we enter in on Channel 6 News Tower.
And my first note is just very similar to my last note in the last episode. It's just, fuck off, Irma. And it's like...
Men are beasts.
I want to like Irma. But she's the worst written female character that I've ever experienced
Why?
In
all
my
the,
life.
All the female characters
because she's stereotypical
show.
Or weak or...
She's stereotypical. She's whiny. She cries at the drop of a hat.
She craves a man's attention.
Yeah, that's her whole identity is based around men. And like April is also like a little better, but
she is a little bit. She's a lot better than Irma, but she's not great.
I feel it's just part disappointing.
Of the, I
it's
feel like part of the problem is all the men in this yeah. world are very chauvinistic.
That too.
Yeah. Not the turtles.
Yeah.
Are they men?
I would say regular, yeah. regular.
These turtle boys.
Regular townspeople.
They're 13
though.
At least.
Yeah.
So
but
like
you're right.
every
else
other
are
interaction.
Assholes.
From like the chorus, if you will. Mm-hmm. So her boss, Vernon, any shop
Shredder
owner
is a fucking asshole.
Yeah.
Well, he's an asshole to everyone. He's not singling her
okay,
out.
Okay. No, no, no. Every tertiary character.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
How about that?
Yes. Yeah.
That's as specific as I can get.
Yes.
Can I say my first note?
Yeah.
I am very tired.
Yeah.
How tired are you?
Originally, I wasn't going to write that.
Uh-huh.
But then I thought, is this kind of like my diary? Like, am I going to go back? Like, I want to first know where I was emotionally
yeah.
at this time. So now...
It was 60 degrees outside.
It was 60 degrees outside. I was so
hazy.
Tired.
I wish it was 60 degrees outside. It's been warm.
I had a medium poop.
It was all right.
I took a medium poop.
I took a medium
also,
poop.
Also, I have another theory that maybe... April is secretly in love with Irma.
Why? I'm not going to shut you down.
I
want to hear what you have
I
to
wanna
say.
I
want to
hear you out.
Well, first
yeah.
of all, you'd have to love someone a lot to stick with them.
Unless you're an idiot.
What do you mean?
Well, I'm saying because she's so obnoxious and needy.
But like, she's not needy with April, really. I mean, she's a little bit, but not like...
Well, I mean, it's like a lot, like, you know, she cries on her shoulder a lot. And, you know, like, April's like, they're there, very comforting. She doesn't seem to be interested in men.
You know what
just
still
saying.
Weirds me out?
That's
kind of
true.
Touching on what Natalie's saying
yeah.
about April and Irma's relationship.
What at?
I don't remember if it was the last episode or the one before. Oh, it was a 50-foot Irma.
Yes.
It was really weird to me that April kept hounding on Irma about her eating in that episode.
Yes.
Like, yeah. Irma decided to go on a diet, but then April was the one, like, forcibly making it so she couldn't. And the whole time, Irma's like, oh, I'm so hungry. It's like, let her fucking eat, man.
Yeah. Well, it's like
get her some
mom.
Carrots.
What are you yeah. talking about? That's she's being supportive of her friend's choice to be on a diet. What if I said, I feel really unhealthy, I want to be on a diet, and then I said, man, I'm pretty hungry. I could go for a burger. And then you didn't try
and cheese.
Talk me out of it.
I would talk you out of it within reason. I would be like, dude, I thought you're on a diet. Like, let's go get a salad. And then if you're like, now I want a cheeseburger, I'm like, well, he's a fucking grown ass man.
Yeah,
so
true.
I'm not gonna like make you feel like a piece of shit or like demand you do anything.
Why not?
Because it's your body.
Yeah, but if
you
want to
jam a
cheeseburger
on,
maybe,
and I'm having a moment of weak will.
Well, and maybe Irma and April have a close enough relationship that they're like sisters, you know, so it gets a little like...
If you were able to admit that to me, then maybe that would be a different conversation.
Mm-hmm.
But I wouldn't do that to you.
All right. Well, I'd want you to do that to me.
That's weird. You in advance. And we would have to have a conversation on why that made me uncomfortable.
Boundaries.
Because you're non-confrontational?
No, I can be confrontational, but to a certain degree, I don't feel like I should be able to push my will onto you.
Huh.
Like, I would...
Well, yeah.
I want to support you, right?
It's
so
it's...
if you're on a diet, then I really want to support you through that.
Yeah.
But if then you're like, man, fuck this diet, we'd have a conversation, but I wouldn't... I'd let it go.
Saying fuck this diet is different than, oh man, I could really go for a burger right now. And then me saying, should I order the burger? I kind of want to order the burger.
Here's
and then
the
you
difference.
Can say, dude, no, you're on a diet. You really.
Yeah.
This is really important to you.
That's reasonable.
Oh, okay.
With Irma, she's basically starving herself. It's like an 80s anorexic diet, as far as I can tell.
Oh, okay. Yes.
So,
water and lemon.
So it's almost more like she's torturing her.
And cayenne pepper.
Like, if you hadn't eaten in 2 days because you're on a diet, I, to support you, would be telling you to eat some food.
Sure.
Right. But
I wouldn't, like, scold you and try to make you feel like a piece of shit.
I don't even remember why we started talking about the last Irma episode when in this one she's complaining about boys.
Yeah.
Well, we're not. I was commenting on what Natalie was saying about the relationship.
Yeah, a man named
Well, they're definitely codependent.
Yes.
If not.
Eerily so.
Yeah.
Inappropriately so.
Yeah.
So I guess in some way I'm sort of agreeing with you.
Which once again comes back full circle to like really badly written stereotypical female characters that
so
their only relationship is talking about men. Like that's all that they talk
about. Yeah. We should make that into a show. Stereotypical female lady in a chauvinistic animated world.
It'd be like The View.
The View.
Right, ladies? And then everyone like applauds. And then this hot doctor comes out.
We should start another show for the opposite of the spectrum. Like tough independent female women that don't need no man. Hi,
could
everyone.
Could it just be G.I. Joe,
view.
But like all the faces are replaced with Barbie faces?
G.I. Jane.
No, it's like the G.I. Joe cartoon, but just like all the faces have just been badly pasted over by like Barbie faces.
I don't get it, but sure.
I'm just saying, you know, we're lazy.
Okay.
We don't need to animate a whole new show.
Well, I didn't even say animated.
Is that his desk? Is that that? What? Her boss. What the frick is his name?
Well, we're... I kind of want to talk more about this.
Oh,
do
sure,
it.
That's fine.
Irma is complaining about her boyfriend.
Yes.
That her new guy that
men
she was
beasts.
Gonna go on a date with, a double date, but he brought another girlfriend, which Cranston pointed out is a terrible three-way joke in a kid's cartoon.
It wasn't so much a three-way joke. So she makes a joke, and you can go and put the clip in. She basically...
Do what I want. I'm putting the clip in.
His idea of a double date was showing up with another girlfriend.
Thank you. She basically says, give me a second.
Men are beasts.
Yeah, but then she goes,
We went on a double date, and he brought...
His idea of
a double date.
His other girlfriend.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. His idea of a double date is him bringing his girlfriend along. So, they're not, yeah, it's still overly, but the, god damn it, I'm so tired. that specifically isn't the part that I thought was weird.
Yeah, the weird part
because she's saying, like, this guy's a piece of crap and I'm not going to date him.
Right.
That, at least, is sort of empowering. Mm-hmm. I don't agree with that 100%, but it's something.
Yeah.
Later, she then says, when April's running off, if she wants to go on
a hot story,
if she wants to go on a double date. And to me, that sounds like she's calling back to what she said about the other guy's opinion. So she's saying it'd be like...
She says a double date with the three of us.
I don't think so. Play right now.
Where are you going? I'm not finished complaining about men yet.
Later, Irma. I'm on to something hot.
Find out if he wants to double date with the two of us.
Yeah, she says, find out if he wants to double date with the two of us. That to me sounds like she's implying it'd be her, April, and a guy.
Maybe she, like,
which
thinks,
seems inappropriate for a children's cartoon.
Maybe she's, like, questioning her idea about double dates. Like, maybe she's wondering, like, have I been wrong about double dates all this time?
She probably is to a degree. She's probably asking herself if...
Something's wrong with her.
I interpret it as she's so desperate.
Yep.
That she would be willing to do this guy's version of a double date.
Yeah.
With April.
Right. Like, basically accompany April on a date.
Yeah.
Whatever it is.
Which is really weird and inappropriate.
But we get a fourth wall break.
We do.
Because as April says, because you're too eager, you don't see me jumping at the
every time a man calls for me. Yeah.
And then her boss calls for her and she goes, right away, sir. And Irma looks to the camera and says, oh, brother. Which makes perfect sense. It's her boss. It's not like, I mean, I'm sure if his boss was a female, she'd still go, right away, ma'am.
Yeah, I think it's just supposed to draw parallels that, like, she's married to her work.
Yes.
You know? Like, well, there's still a parallel there for a pretty sexist joke, I think.
Well, that's...
Yeah, yeah. But they make it sexist. It's like,
oh,
you
absolutely.
Don't see me jumping whenever a man calls, and then she literally just does that.
That she literally does it.
She, like,
so
sprints to the other.
Women are objects.
Yes.
Kids.
Oh, also,
learn from
my
this.
Favorite
learn
line.
From this.
My favorite line of this is...
Is lining crack? I just snorted.
Yeah.
Oh. You snort crack, right?
Great.
I don't feel good, Case.
You crush it up fine enough. I'm sure you could.
You can.
When Irma says,
I don't think you're supposed to.
Wait, stop, April. I'm not done complaining about men.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's normal, though.
Don't go do your job.
Yeah,
Let
I know.
Me whine at you some more.
Don't go banging my heart.
You're getting paid to I sit there and complain about men.
What does Irma do in this office?
She's the secretary, I guess.
What?
Or
she
the receptionist.
Never answers the phone. Do you ever
no
see her
phone
well,
on her desk?
I would just like to
what
point
does she
out
do?
It's a flat
would,
table
I would
with no drawers.
Simply like to point out that this show is not Irma Hour. They don't show her entire 24-hour day. She could be answering phones, but they decide not to animate that because who gives a shit?
Who gives a shit about this part?
No one.
Exactly.
It'd be even worse, though, if it was just her answering phones and doing secretarial work.
Welcome to the Irma Hour. We're answering phones, secretarial work.
Channel 6, this is Irma. Oh my god, did you hear about Richard?
Yeah,
just Richard
gossip.
Dumped me again. Again, I know.
Could you
I'm sorry, who do you want to talk to?
Could you transfer me to Vernon, please?
Yeah, Vernon. Oh my god, did you hear what he did?
He dumped me again.
He dumped me again.
Could you just... Really,
again, I know!
I have a really important story.
I'm fingering myself right now.
Oh, okay.
What are you wearing? Are you single?
No, please, please transfer me to Vernon.
I'll transfer you to Vernon after you tell me if you're single or not. This has slowly turned into my little kid
voice.
Shut
up! What?
It slowly turned into my child voice.
See, she has to deal with it. Handing it off to you, Natalie. All right.
Daddy.
Thanks.
There's a man on the phone who wants to talk to you about work. I'm your secretary. Don't ignore me.
All the turtles are down in the sewer.
That's shit, man. I have a note. Great office, bro.
Yes.
He has a wall full of CRT televisions.
Turned off.
And then there's like a table in the middle of a tile floor that has a single... It's like a typewriter,
sort of,
but like reports are coming in, like a stock ticker.
Yeah.
It's a news ticker.
Like, what is that machine? Is he getting messages from other reporters?
It's the room's like creepily matrix-like, though.
Yeah, there's like nothing on the wall.
It's just screens and then like an empty room. Like it's
maybe he's the architect.
One time, yeah. It's not even like a super full weird. Desk. It's like a third of a desk. Like it's just big enough to fit this machine.
Yeah, it's like there's a no little drawers. Coffee table.
And there's nothing else in this room. It's weird.
Let's get to the meat of the episode.
Those
the
are turtles... all my notes for a long time.
Oh, no, we have to talk about this now. The fucking pizza machine.
The giant can opener.
Okay. So Donatello created the machine that looks a lot like the one from the intro, but isn't. He says it's a giant pizza maker, and he just dumps a bunch of flour and tomatoes into a bucket, into a receptacle bin in the machine, turns it on, and it starts shooting out pizzas, which they eat and catch, and
you know
they're delicious, apparently.
It is pretty impressive.
Super impressive.
Because, like, it's... What impresses me is that he just dumps the ingredients in the same hole.
Yeah.
Together.
The machine knows.
The machine is able to like
make the dough.
Yeah. It seems like the machine has to do a lot more work than it really needs to. Like he could have, if he just made separate places for you to dump the flour and tomatoes.
That would already be impressive.
For this to actually be possible, it would have to be like nuclear powered.
Probably.
How do you figure that?
Well, how quickly, how much, like, power and energy, just, like, it happens in, like, a minute.
Yeah, but we can do a lot of crazy shit if you use a lot of electricity.
And you see how big this is.
They're in the sewer. It's probably hydroelectric.
You know, it's said...
That's the smartest thing I've ever said.
It is.
It is.
Hydro-powered.
Donatello says it'll make pizzas in half the time. But it makes an entirely cooked pizza in literally 8 seconds.
Yeah.
That's more than
it's
half.
Insane.
Oh, and he hasn't even cranked it up to max.
Oh, yeah,
no,
but when
he
does, it explodes.
Down a min.
It explodes.
So it explodes and...
Of course.
Of course. And it gets dough all over the place and shit. Which, it's unnecessary that it goes any faster than this.
All for the sake of a joke.
No, a plot point.
Oh, that...
It hurts Leonardo's arm.
Well, they could have hurt Leo's arm a lot of different ways.
Yes.
Anyway.
But they decided to do a stupid joke. It's like, I love Lucy, too many chocolates coming through.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and then the steering wheel.
He has a steering wheel valve.
Where did the steering wheel come from?
He put it there, Natalie. He built this.
No, but I mean...
What's difficult?
He was using buttons and switches to control it earlier.
Yeah.
So why does he have... Like,
because now it's cranked up to max, and now he has to go into manual control.
He's trying to override it.
He's trying to override it.
You obviously don't know anything about
giant
pizza makers.
The pipes are going to burst. He has to open the valve pipe for
the pressure.
Steam fluids.
Just unplug it.
Yeah, pressure.
No, it's hydroelectric. You can't unplug a hydroelectric machine.
Disconnect it.
From what?
From
the
power. From...
It's too late.
It's too late.
Anyway. There's a steering wheel.
Anyway, it explodes.
Pizza.
Oh, and
Leo hurts his arm. It's so sad.
Oh, he has a bruise.
Something exploded and hit his arm. To the point where he's like holding his arm, and Splinter says, "Leonardo, are you injured?" At which point Leo says, "Yeah, it's just a bruise, though." And
Splinter is really needy.
He's really worried about Leo.
Were you injured, Leonardo?
Just a bruise, Master. I'll be fine.
He's like, he feels like he's being friend-zoned by Leo.
I am coming with you.
But Master Splinter!
You are injured. Perhaps I can be of some assistance if it comes to an unfriendly encounter.
So he's like, I'll follow you to the kitchen. He's like, well, I don't really... I'm just going to grab a glass of water. Would you like me to get you ice? Please, use my special mug.
There's also a part which I just want to point out. Raph talks from Leonardo, but his mouth is not on Leonardo's body.
Yeah, that was really fucking weird. The mouth was like a whole turtle
off center off his face, like floating in the air.
Yeah.
It's hard to explain. Whatever.
We'll try to make a GIF. I don't know if it'll come out, though.
There's an Illuminati code that we need to decode.
What?
We need to crack. Like, that's where all the weird, like, why there's an empty room. It all means something. It's like a code that we have to.
Now,
the lizard people left for us.
I know from your drunken talkings last night that you were really into talking about H.P. Lovecraft.
I have a huge, huge hard-on for H.P. Lovecraft.
Especially right now.
It's gigantic. You should see it.
The hard-on or the H.P. Lovecraft?
Both.
Oh, okay.
The H.P. Lovecraft.
Yeah.
The Lovecraft.
You know.
Is what I like to call him. Good old Henry.
Well, guys, Splinter sure is upset about his pal Leo.
So he needs
he better
to make
go
sure.
on a dangerous combat mission with him.
Yeah, so April says there's something going on at Cybertech Laboratories. And so she's in the lab in the rafters, and Shredder and Bebop and Rocksteady are there fucking around with something. Oh no, they're trying to bring back a thermocouple galvanometer. Thermocouple galvanometer.
I have a question. Is this the first time that we've seen April with like a handheld
no.
camera? Okay.
She has it often. It does magically change sizes.
Sure.
But she often has a handheld camera.
I'm just glad that like she doesn't have to depend on Vernon anymore.
I just noticed something weird.
Yes.
She drops the wrench.
Yeah.
Straight off this catwalk that seems really high up.
Yeah.
It lands in front of Shredder and startles him, like it almost hits his foot.
Yeah.
He looks up, but then he's looking
like kind of
way
upward.
Out, and she's like not off the ground at all.
Yeah, she's not that high up in this shot.
No, he could. It
but in
seems
the last
like
shot, she was super high.
She was, and on top of that, like she's wearing her camouflage yellow bright jumper.
Yeah.
So super it's hard to detect. Yeah, exactly. Against this green and shit purple background.
Someone needs to give her a fucking lesson.
Yeah, exactly.
How about just like normal clothes? Like, why do you only have
do
one
Do you not understand
jumpsuit?
The benefits of the speed suit?
She also has
I don't have time to get into this
no,
right now.
Please,
but...
Cranston, get into it. Tell me three benefits of the yellow speed suit. Speed suit.
Number one.
Practical.
Number two.
Cargo pockets.
Number three.
It's easy.
Easy for what?
Easy to get into, easy to take off.
Okay.
That's why they call it a speed suit.
It does sound
It's stain resistant.
Because it's made out of leather that you can hear move when you move.
Ooh, I never pictured it made out of leather.
Yeah, it's like a latex leather.
No,
kind of a...
it's like cottony.
Nah.
Nah.
It's like yellow leather.
You sure it's not red leather?
So, I think the galvanizers.
It's yellow leather.
Do you think the
red leather, yellow leather?
The thermocouple galvanometer.
Yes, the galvanometer.
What are you doing into the microphone right now, Natalie?
Sorry,
she was checking her notes.
Notes.
Don't.
She has like
don't
four
do that.
Pages of notes.
Do it far away from the microphone.
I'll tell you right now. I have 7 lines of notes, and you have 3 pages.
I have two pages.
Okay.
And I space them.
I have 6 notes if you count. I am tired.
Sometimes they're just reactions. Like this note just says, "Of course."
That's not very helpful.
I'll remember when we get.
Can
there.
We get into the main plot here, or do you guys have notes speaking up or coming up?
Yeah, I was gonna say that they're the giant balls with spikes suspended from the air in this laboratory. Those are the galvanometers?
No, because it was in the box.
No, that's part of the brain switcher.
So there's a brain switching device.
Yeah.
And it has like two
giant platforms.
And the turtles and Splinter show up to rescue April, and they have a sweet battle. The battle's so sweet, guys. Actually, I did like this battle.
Do you guys... You guys remember how the episode's called The Old Switcheroo?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Well, here's why.
Uh-huh.
Hold on to your hats.
Because Splinter and Shredder get on different platforms, and then they switch.
Switch what?
Everything.
Personality.
No, they don't switch everything.
Like
if they switch everything, it'd be called a teleporter.
Yeah, and it wouldn't teleport very far.
Yeah.
So they have the same body, mm-hmm. but they have all the memories, thoughts,
minds.
Emotions.
Mm-hmm. And personality.
Mannerisms.
It was a neuron mind transfer.
Yes.
For you scientists out there, you'll know what I'm talking
about. Yeah, you'll know what that means.
That's
Natalie's taking a flash photography right now.
Too many gun clicks.
Oh, I
Who
thought
are you
we
pointing
agreed,
at?
I thought we agreed it was flash photography.
Group. No, she was pointing at groups, though. She was like, and then over here. And then a third one.
Yeah, she's taking pictures of them.
And
all.
I would have been winking, but I only have one eye that blinks, so just imagine it.
Wow, real personal.
That's the weirdest thing you could have said.
That's the weirdest thing because we've never talked about that on the show.
The weirdest way you could have put it.
I have a fake eye.
The only
that's it.
The
Is
end.
That it? All right. Natalie has a fake eye. Only one of her eyes works. Whatever. You can send us an email if you want to know more.
It's really beautifully painted.
Yes, it is.
So stop me if you guys have something to say before this, but long story short, the brains get switched.
Yep.
Why I wrote, of course, because the fight is perfectly choreographed so that one of them falls on one platform
but
and the other one falls
good,
on
though,
the other.
Right?
Yeah, no, it's fun. It, that's what I'm saying. It's
I
like,
don't know.
But it's obviously choreographed to be that way.
Yeah.
So Shredder and Splinter goes home.
Switch baddies.
With the turtles. And then Splinter and Shredder goes with Bebop and Rocksteady.
Because they're passed out, so they can't, like,
yeah.
Yeah.
Say, you know.
So they essentially wake up in each other's lair.
Yeah, essentially.
Essentially. They have to...
They have to figure out that
they're... Splinter has to have a cold compress over his eyes.
Bebop and Rocksteady steal a food truck.
So, can I say my point?
Which is the smartest thing they've ever done. Cranston's a grumpy Gus. Go ahead, buddy.
You're talking over me.
Yeah, you talk over everyone. We talk over each other. That's how we do the show.
Yeah, but I was trying to make a point, and then you guys just went on.
No. That's what happens. We talk over each other. You do it to me all the time. It's not a big deal.
It is.
No. Shouldn't be.
I want to hear Steven's point.
I do, too. They switch bodies. There was a cold compress. They wake up and
Splinter has a cold compress over his eyes because he has to, because he's injured. And conveniently, that means that Shredder can't actually know where the turtle's lair is.
For the sake of keeping things straight, I think we should say Shredder when we mean Shredder in Splinter's body.
We can try whatever you want.
Yeah, it's going to be confusing.
Yeah,
let's say Shredder Splinter and Splinter Shredder and then figure that out. Why don't we say Good Master, Bad Master?
Okay.
Good Master, Bad Master.
Why don't we just use their Japanese name?
Well, here's the thing. So they start trying to pretend that they're the other person.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So
because they don't want to get caught.
Well, and they also realize the strategic value of that.
Well, sort of. Because my point is that Shredder in Splinter's body starts making them super train in Shredder's training way.
Yeah.
Wouldn't that be the worst thing you can do?
In what way? Like to be found out?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm going to pretend I'm someone else and then I'm going to train you to defeat me.
Well, I think what he was doing was trying to get them tired so that he could destroy them. Like, overwork them. But it didn't come out like
that. I picture it, like, taking, like, 3 years. Yeah. And eventually they're, like, they're basically Foot Clan.
Yeah, yeah. They're super
strong. And then suddenly he's like, I've been Shredder the whole time. And then they immediately, like, tactically beat the fuck out of him. Yeah.
Squash him like a
button. Every move he does, like, they have the perfect counter move for it.
Yeah. Oh, no, I've taught them too well.
Yeah
exactly.
Well, at least in this...
Why train him?
But he doesn't tell them to do things... His way. He does.
He just tells them to do ninja
do
exercises.
Do their ninja exercises 10 times.
Yeah. Oh, that's true.
But when
you know,
he
maybe.
Fights them,
I figure there's that part then, of that is training.
Yeah, but when he fights them, then he doesn't train them. They train each other. They like do their exercises together. Then he comes into the room and beats the shit out of them.
Yeah, but then he's like, fight me, learn my moves.
Yeah.
Yeah, he basically gives himself
away. That was
away.
A training, that was a sparring match.
See,
that
I
was
think,
training.
I think that would be a good thing for Splinter, actual Splinter, to do.
Yes.
Is to teach, is to be like, well, every time we fight, you think it's me, and so you counter my fighting style, but I'm going to change it up, and oh, I beat the shit out of you.
Well, if he decided he was going to beat the shit out of him and kill them right then that would make total sense to me.
But all he does is beat them up and there's like
all he does is beat them up
and
like
then walks away.
And then makes them do chores.
And then makes them do chores. See, like at least the chores I get. Like make them do stupid shit.
Yeah get them tired.
But it's like
and then kill them.
Train them a lot.
No,
go
he doesn't want to kill them. He wants to destroy them. He specifically says that like 3 times, which I don't know what that is.
Because they don't want to say kill.
He then mentions killing them.
Oh.
Later in the episode. I don't know. It seems stupid to me. That he would, like, fight them in his own way, I guess.
Yeah,
it was.
He's Shredder stupid, too.
Yeah. No, he absolutely is.
He's an idiot.
That's essentially my point.
Yeah.
What I like is that Splinter, who's in Shredder's body, Splinter takes the tactical advantage
With Krang,
and he tries, and he, in his head, he's thinking, this is great. Now I'm going to be able to find out where the Technodrome is. Let me do this for a while.
Yeah, and maybe I can trick Krang into helping me get my mind switched back.
Yes, but...
Which seems stupid, but go ahead.
But the first part of that was, oh, sweet, now I get to find out where the Technodrome is.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And then he goes into this giant metal drill, and he starts drilling straight down, and he's like, my thought is that he's like, huh.
It's right here.
I can't do it. This knowledge does nothing for me. Yeah.
We'll get in this drill vehicle that I don't have.
And can't program.
Well, here's
and
the thing.
It's like, how do you keep track of like where you're going in the earth?
I know.
Yeah,
it's like, huh. So this is somewhere hundreds of miles below the surface of the
down,
earth.
Down and then.
Down more.
And then.
Huh.
You're there.
Okay. Well,
here's my question.
This does me no good.
In the hell cave. Yes, Natalie.
Do they drill new holes every time?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And then lava comes up and fills up. The lava comes up and fills up.
But where's the lava?
In the center of the earth.
Yeah. In the center of the earth. There's magma.
Oh, my God. It's not how it works.
No. Think about it. It's the drill superheats the ground and rock. Maybe it's not lava, but it's molten rock.
Well, if they hit
superheated and pushed back.
If there's lava in the earth and it's under pressure, and then you create a hole to the surface, it'll come up.
Right, yeah. But you'd have to drill so deep.
That's what they're implying.
The Technodome realm is way. I thought it was
literally the center of the earth.
Literally the center of the earth.
Literally the center of the earth. It might not be literally the center of the earth now, because it might have moved a little bit.
Okay.
Well. It is in a cavern.
Is it totally immobile, or can it still kind of like move along? Because they're in a big cave. Basically.
Right now, it cannot move.
Okay,
it's
at all
non-functioning.
So they're probably still at the center of the earth.
Yes. Yeah. It fell through a pocket of lava at the end of the second season.
Oh.
And stopped in the middle of the center of the earth.
So, okay. Bassem.
Yes.
Let's pretend you're Splinter.
Yes.
Please describe yourself physically. How strong are you?
Splinter?
Yeah, you're Splinter. How strong are you?
I'm pretty strong.
You're pretty strong.
In my human body, I was able to defeat even of enemies.
I'm
in
just
the Foot
interested
Clan.
For this point of conversation.
Yes.
The only thing I'm interested in is you right now.
Yeah, so as a rat, my strength has at least doubled.
So you can lift things, like you're strong that way, but how durable would you say your body is?
Due to age, I'm probably a little frailer than I should be.
A little frail. Do you have to use anything for assisted for walking?
I use a walking stick for balance, but it is also part of an act.
It is, but you also have a creaky back. And you're also constantly like...
My knees bother me sometimes. They got skinnier.
He's been sleeping in a sewer for like the past 20 years, so...
Yeah.
Okay. Now, take that. Now you're Shredder.
Yes.
Explain yourself physically.
Okay. Not only am I in the peak of my physical condition...
Yes.
I am absolutely beautiful.
You are also a human.
Yes.
So you can actually do things. You have armor.
Yes.
He can break things with just like barely thinking about it.
Yeah, like slice through things. Yeah.
Why does Splinter want his old fucking rat ass body back? He could take down Krang, Bebop, Rocksteady right now.
You're right.
Easily.
You're absolutely right.
Easily.
But it's not his body. That's weird.
It's not his body, but I would argue that Splinter, his rat body's not really his body either.
We had an episode where he had the chance to turn back into human.
I love how excited you are.
And he did, and didn't like it. He didn't like being human anymore.
Well, you got to go for your opportunities, man.
But what are you going to do with the other body? Just wait until maybe someday you want to be a rat again? No, that's awful.
Well, as a rat, he's still stronger than just a regular human.
A regular human. But he's not stronger
Shredder
than Shredder.
Just a regular human.
Well, I think Shredder...
Shredder's not a regular human.
Yeah, Shredder's evenly matched with Splinter in most battles, it seems.
Okay.
And he fights dirty.
Sure.
But
and
Splinter is a fucking
badass.
And he has
blades all over his body.
Yes.
I don't want to take away from Splinter's badass. All I'm saying is this seems like he's in an advantageous position.
Sure.
Well, at least he could just fucking annihilate Bebop and Rocksteady right now.
He wouldn't have any of his rat powers.
As soon as he gets to the drill.
So he doesn't have his tail. Yeah.
In the drill, as it's going down to the Technodrome. Slice, slice. Dead. What happened, Shredder? The Leonardo got him.
Krang's dead.
Yeah.
Krang's dead.
Slice, yeah.
Slice. Well, and then, but no, they have the Rock Warriors and everything. You have to be more strategic about that.
Okay.
Yeah, but.
But they were alone.
But you get rid of the muscle.
I feel like Splinter's the fucking smart one.
Yeah.
Like, he could figure this out.
Yeah. Definitely.
And he could even go back to Splinter Body if he wants. After he defeats them, they captured Splinter.
Yep.
Which would be easy with the four turtles.
Yep.
And him. And they, like, tie him up, switch him back, and then immediately kill Shredder. Because, like, he intentionally immobilizes himself before he switches back. Turtles, tie me up.
Yeah.
Oh, to stay as a rat?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So he ties himself up when he's in Shredder's body.
Yeah.
They switch.
What's his motivation here?
To be a rat again.
I guess.
It just feels right, man.
He just has, like, all this opportunity to learn all this stuff about Krang and this technology, and all he wants to do is learn about the fucking mind swap again.
He really wants to be a rat again.
Yeah, but he's got so much time to do
He's got
to
get back to the status quo.
Because the episode's only 20 minutes long.
Yeah, he has got 20 minutes to turn back into normal so we can start this again next time.
Oh, man.
He has to get back together with Leo.
Yeah, that's what he longs for Leo.
Maybe
for Leo.
Leonardo will love me more if I look like this.
Maybe I won't be in the friend zone.
Yeah, he knows that, like...
I don't know why I did that.
Leo would never go for those luscious Shredder lips. Which, for some reason, are animated so that they're just, like, so full and beautiful.
He looks absolutely gorgeous.
He does. We see him
really
without
does.
His mask.
Whatever they
the
do, it's always so shocking
while.
To
every
me.
Time,
yeah,
every
he's
time we see him without
gorgeous.
His mask. He's absolutely beautiful.
And then it's like, why wear the mask, baby?
This shot right here, I'm putting on Twitter.
Yeah,
even Rocksteady looks amazed. Look at him.
He's a fucking
well,
Disney prince.
Shredder right now has like a beautiful like who's the dude from Sailor Moon? Tuxedo mask.
Yes.
He's fucking
profile.
Tuxedo
yeah,
mask
yeah.
ass face right now. Tuxedo mask ass face. Ass mask ass face.
And Rocksteady is in
mask
love.
Ass face.
Rocksteady looks
oh,
like
Shredder.
He is absolutely in love with him.
You want to see where I can put my horn?
You make my Rocksteady.
I'm going to be bopping you all night.
Hey, that's me.
I'm going to bebop that ass.
In the anus. Anus.
Continue.
When Shredder is nice, everyone loses their minds.
I know, right? But when Splinter's mean, he's just having a bad
They're
day.
Like, oh, he must be mad at us.
Did we do something wrong, guys?
What did we do to piss him off? But yeah, when Shredder's like, says thank you, Bebop and Rocksteady, you're like, who the fuck are you?
I don't mind this version of Splinter as a hard-ass trainer.
He really should be to some extent.
In the new cartoon, that's basically how he is anyway.
Right.
And the movies.
And this version of Shredder, where he has like honor and everything, it's still really good. Mm-hmm. I think it just is more... Okay, let me explain. Krang gives him shit for not getting the thermocouple galvanometer.
Well, did you bring me a thermocouple galvanometer as I told you?
I have to look it up every time.
Yeah, he totally dropped the ball on that.
And so he says, we will return to the surface and retrieve it.
And Krang's like, what?
He's
why
like,
aren't
what?
You whining like a little bitch?
Yeah,
exactly.
He like, admitted his mistake
and
Krang
like,
was like, what?
I failed to achieve victory. I am the one responsible.
I must take responsibility. And that is like, I think Shredder should be like that anyway.
Yeah, that would be fucking cool.
Yeah.
Right,
I'd actually care about
more,
Shredder.
Like, honor,
exactly.
respect.
Instead
yeah.
of just being a bumbling fool.
You are right, Cranston. I would care about Shredder if his goals were taken seriously.
Yeah.
Even
instead,
if
he's a little bitch.
Yeah.
But they
whines,
don't
want to
make an interesting cartoon. They just, Shredder's bad and he's a fool. Like, that's his thing.
Yeah.
Later on,
yeah.
Also,
they drive like 45 miles out to the fucking drill.
Yeah, from the
but
drill.
That's unrelated.
Why?
It's just weird.
Because they needed to go right above the Technodrome.
When all
it
other
only
times
goes
they
down.
Just drill up to any random part wherever the fuck they're just like, we need these diamonds. And they like go from the other room and they walk, they go through the door to get the diamonds. Lips again. I like how his lips are the same color as the rest of his face.
You're falling in love with Shredder now?
It's, I mean,
it's all about the lips.
That means we have a new song. Natalie Shredder, Natalie Shredder.
Love forever, down in the sewer, down in the Technodrome.
Where do we go? We don't know. That's why we always roam.
But our shuttle only goes up and down. It's not a very good shuttle.
And the only hole that we know is brown.
Because the earth, the ground is brown.
Because the ground is brown.
No. I was talking about buttholes.
That means that the Technodrome is literally in Browntown.
Rollo Tony Browntown.
Is Krang a little bit of a diva?
Yes.
Like maybe a lot of bit of a diva?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
He really like, he wants to be in control.
No, Shaki.
Careful.
I need to get that myself.
That's my last electroinductoscope.
Don't drop it, you fools.
So I'm kind of jumping ahead here, but
that's fine.
It's my last kind of note.
Yeah.
Eventually, Splinter inside Shredder is like, well, I need to tell the turtles what's up.
Yeah.
I need to somehow get it to them that I'm actually Splinter.
Yes, when they fight each other.
So they come up to the surface.
Yep.
And he jumps out with Bebop and Rocksteady.
Yep.
And the turtles are like, oh, we're going to fight. And he's like, no, wait, please don't fight. I'm actually Splinter. And then he just sits back and watches while Bebop and Rocksteady fight him. Why wouldn't he just like start beating the fuck out of Bebop and Rocksteady? He could easily, because he's behind them.
Yeah.
They don't suspect a thing. He's just like, and they're gone.
Yeah.
And then he could have been like, guys, hang on a second.
Wait a minute.
I need to explain something to you. Do you see how I killed these guys? I did that because I'm Splinter.
Also, I hate pizza.
I hate pizza. My name is Splinter.
This was the plot point that, like, they start getting suspicious because Shredder in Splinter's body greedily takes the pizza and starts eating a whole slice. And, like, we thought you hated pizza.
He's like, don't question me.
And Leo looks so, he, like, reverts back to a child.
Oh, no, Daddy's eating pizza.
Why would Daddy eat the pizza?
Daddy, why are you eating pizza? I thought you don't like pizza. That's why we always eat pizza.
Looks so sad.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe like they're sad because it's like now they have to share.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Less pizza. Fuck.
But we had a system worked out.
God damn it. You ate the sushi.
There's four of us. We divide that by four. Now there's five of us? How do you cut a pizza in fives?
Well, with simple mathematics.
Shut up.
Boo that man.
Well, I have my clear acrylic compass. I just onto the pizza and we'll measure out the degrees. Now, if we take 360 degrees, we divide that by five.
I think I have a theory about Splinter and why he doesn't just stab Bebop and Rocksteady. Like, I think he genuinely, like, does not... He wants to avoid violence at all costs. Which just seems
sure,
weird, because he's training them how to fight.
He says that all the time, but then what he also says is that Shredder must be stopped.
Yes.
Like, he is totally passive, but he's constantly telling the turtles that we need to keep Shredder out of the picture, otherwise the world will never be safe.
Yeah. And not only that, but his sons are being shot at by laser beams. So, I mean,
yeah,
he
should just stab
them in the back of their neck.
I agree, but
sever the spine,
like,
just a little quick, the third vertebrae.
Yeah, he tried to stop it with words. He tried to be like, everyone stop fighting.
Splinter
I command you.
In Shredder's body. So not even Shredder himself. Basically goes up to a lock and chain and just like, yeah, just puts his fist on it with his blades and goes, rip.
Like
and
it's
it just...
made out of Twizzlers.
Less than Twizzlers.
Paper Twizzlers.
I don't even know what you'd call it. It's so fragile and brittle when he puts his claw to it.
It's like a single strand of fiber optic cable.
Well, fiber optic might be kind of...
No, that's right. It's flexible. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Either way, it just fucking disintegrates with the slightest touch.
Yes.
He'd kill him any way he wants.
Mm-hmm. You're
doesn't
right.
Doesn't have to go for the neck. He could just be like...
You can make it look like an accident, too. Here's what you do. You lay on the ground and trip them onto your shins. They become impaled. You have blades everywhere. You give them a hug, they die.
What if you could also just make it look like an actual accident?
Yeah.
Instead of like, they fell on my knees.
Yeah. Why not?
Yeah.
Why push them off a building? They fell off a building.
The drill malfunctioned and this piece of metal
my knees.
Severed their necks.
Shocky, you couldn't just get out of the way with your ninja powers?
Everybody hates Bebop and Rocksteady, so no one would miss them if they were
Well,
gone.
They say that, but I think Shredder likes them.
Yeah.
Only because he created them, so he feels like...
Yeah, they're his.
Mama?
Oh, Baba.
Mama!
But I love that Krang is just like, please take them with you.
Daddy, my name's Bebop.
Hey, Bebop.
Hi, Daddy.
Oh.
I'm a warthog.
Yeah.
And I will do your bidding.
Cool.
My name is Rocksteady.
Okay. I'm not very smart, though, so I'll bring you the wrong beer.
That's... Well, I only have one kind of beer in the fridge. This is milk!
See, that's how our relationship's gonna work, but you still have to love me. Because you're my daddy.
The fact that you're saying this is amazing. Oh, I just love that you're like, I'm gonna get this. It sounds like you're doing it on purpose, I have to be honest, Bebop.
Well, no, it's just that's our dynamic.
That's rather insightful for someone who doesn't know the difference between beer and milk.
You know, sometimes I could be very mindful, Daddy. I'm mindful, but my intelligence is low.
Tell you what, here's a laser gun. Go shoot at some turtles.
Okay, Daddy. But I'm not.
Poorly.
I'm never going to kill them.
Yeah, never actually hit them.
Yeah, I mean, I might hit them once in a while, but it won't do
anything.
Well,
that's fine. I don't need you to kill them. I just want you to go have fun.
Thanks, Daddy.
Does Bebop have a rat bone necklace?
Yeah. No, it's like turtle bones.
This is actually Sculpey that I made in summer camp.
Oh, well, it's very good.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you so
much.
They
look like real bones.
You're really nice.
Oh, well, thank
you. Should
you.
Marry my daddy. He's very lonely.
I'm really into this other girl that I'm
He
I'm
says that
with,
he can't drink away his feelings anymore. And that's why he takes it out on the wall.
On the turtles.
Well, first it was the dog, but then the dog didn't come back.
Yeah, it went away.
Daddy, where'd the dog go?
It went up north.
To the farm.
Is he with Santa?
Yes.
Daddy!
He's making it. When you get presents every year, it's from Spot.
I just want Spot back, though.
Nah. He's helping Santa make you presents.
Spot taught me how to be a man.
No, that doesn't make sense.
He was very gentle,
doing?
Daddy.
What were you doing with that dog?
He was very gentle?
Well, yes. Spot was a loving dog.
Uh-huh.
Can we talk about the moment where...
Please.
Bebop... grabs
that's
Mikey's
a good period to that.
Let's table that.
No.
No.
We're not tabling any of that.
Kaioken.
No.
Times.
No.
750.
God damn it.
Bebop. But I've blown up because I said 750.
Oh. Bebop grabs Mikey's nunchuck. And swings Mikey around above his head like a helicopter.
And if you could put in
just
the sound
let
clip,
go.
Awesome.
Just sure. let go,
I
Mikey.
I believe it's something like this. Whoa!
Saki! No, what? That was happening in the other room. Sorry.
Tell me to put in a sound clip. You have to give me a second so that I can actually find a blank spot to put it. Put the sound clip in here, and then also do this, and then that.
Just put it in over the top of us. That should be Casey's new ringtone.
Oh shit! Bassam's calling me again.
Why
she doesn't
you pick
want
up?
The crim
because I love
jingle as her as her
she
ringtone.
Does. She does. She really does.
We know what you ate last night.
I guess.
Anyway, why does Mikey just let go? Why doesn't he just
let
go
of
his nunchucks?
Because then he'll fly across the alley.
Yeah, he doesn't want to give up
and
his
then
weapon.
Even
though he's willing to just hurl them.
Literally, just, yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Like,
okay.
three seconds
absolutely.
After that.
What is one of the rules of being a ninja?
To cry.
To obey thine father.
Infidel dogs and run after your enemies.
Jesus Christ, Natalie.
It's in the episode.
No, it's not. You're play just saying here. Something play, racist.
Play the clip here.
But I'm not leaving any blank spots. How am I supposed to play it anywhere?
I don't remember.
I don't
that
think
from
we
the
could
show.
Ever hear that sound clip.
Why would Natalie just say infidel dogs?
Why would you just yell infidel dogs? That's so
Mikey
inappropriate.
It. Is it because
Mikey
of Bassam's skin?
Is it because it's your racism to
Is
me?
Is it your racism to Bassam?
Yes.
Okay, well now how does that make you feel, Bassam?
Makes me feel a little sad.
Yeah, but she was honest with you, so.
Yeah, so I'm being honest.
Yeah, but she was honest with you, so you're kind of, it makes you kind of
I'm not allowed to be sad?
Well, it's kind of rude that she kind of opened up to you and you're not accepting it.
I'm playing the clip.
Prepare for ninja revenge, infidel dogs!
My favorite part is that apparently it's from kung fu movies.
Yeah.
Can anyone
so,
please,
oh, fourth
and
wall
I'm
break.
Seriously.
So it's a fourth wall break.
Yeah.
Michelangelo yells, "Now it's time for my ninja revenge, infidel dogs." And then Donatello says, looks to the screen and says,
"I think he's been watching too many kung fu movies."
Now,
if somebody can find
yes,
a clip of something
think,
like that in a kung fu movie,
I think that's
I will
more
send
common
you
than you might think, Natalie. And first of all, no fucking way we're sending cash. Please don't say that. I don't want that to come
dollar
back
in,
words in
my
Bitcoin.
Mouth.
I don't want it to come bite me like in a lawsuit.
I will give you 45 full Bitcoin.
How much? That's probably expensive.
It's like
20
now. Grand, yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway.
This is continue. Between Natalie and Bassam. I'm not involved in this
between
shit.
Natalie and her bank account.
Anyway.
What the fuck was I even going to say?
Kung
God
fu
damn it.
Kung Fu.
Yes. And they were... a little racist in the older Asian movies.
Okay.
So infidel dogs was perfectly fine.
Yeah.
For them.
Would that... But they would say that to other clans too.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Anyone who doesn't see the same way as you can be
yeah.
an infidel.
The person sure. born across the river is an infidel dog because yeah. they don't want to bow down to the guy that keeps killing all of them.
And the dog that doesn't eat out of my hand is an infidel dog.
Yeah. What an asshole.
Yes. That's why he's up with Santa now.
From what I can recall, especially in the Japanese old movies, infidel dogs was pretty common. And I think maybe still is.
Probably.
All right. Okay.
I'd be okay
you
with
learn
it.
Learn something new.
The more you know,
don't
the
you
better
dare
it
close
comes
your
out.
Eyes.
What?
Hold my breasts, they get bigger.
Do they?
Find out.
You just have to squeeze them. Just
call,
right.
call my bluff, bitch.
They get, you know,
too
they
far
get,
away.
They get well, turgid, like penises do.
Turgent?
Turgid.
Turgid.
Turgid. It's another word for, like, stiff.
I don't
engorged.
Believe you. That's disgusting.
No, something. You can look it up.
You can't
it's
just
an actual
make up
I'm
words,
not going to look
Natalie.
It up. You have to bear the burden of proof.
Yeah.
I don't care if you
it's
believe
two
me
on
not.
One.
Well, then you're wrong.
Then you're wrong.
Okay.
Play both of our theme songs.
Stop doing John Cena.
Can that be my victory song?
Yeah, if you ever get one.
Yeah. If you ever win. Which you did not.
And we'll get sued for copyright.
Again.
For your sake.
I'll shift it a key.
Just make it sound awful.
Bitch shift it. Could you auto-tune that?
Did you guys notice...
What kind of magic do you think I have when I edit?
Auto-tune magic.
Hey, Bassam.
Yes.
You're Splinter again.
Yes,
can you explain to me how you are able to change your brainwaves at will?
Well, you see, when Krang scanned my brainwaves to see if I was Shredder or not...
Yeah, that's actually what I'm referring to.
Mm-hmm. I was able to use sheer force of will to mimic the precise brainwaves of Shredder.
So I understand that you use your force of will, but could you explain to me how it works?
Okay, so you know how...
Like, walk me through the actual process.
All right, yeah, let me kind of give you the process here. So, you know how in Harry Potter...
Mm-hmm.
No, to, but go ahead.
To conjure a Patronus
uh-huh.
charm,
yeah.
you have to think of a happy memory.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, that's Peter Pan.
Get yes. those endorphins running in your brain.
No, that's Harry Potter.
No, it's Peter Pan. Fairy dust, you think magic, you think happy thoughts, you fly.
It's both. Okay. It's both. Yeah. It's okay.
Well, Peter Pan came
so
first.
So what I do is I think of my knowledge of the Shredder.
Okay.
And how he would act.
Yeah.
And I put myself in that state of mind.
Okay.
Oh.
Which, yeah, he's a master of meditation, so I don't think it's that far-fetched.
And then, yeah.
Are you a super actor?
And then I clear my mind, so my brain waves are gone, and then his are
maybe that's all he has to do. He just has to clear his mind. So there's no thoughts, and then Krang's like, "Oh, it is Shredder.
Oh, well, there's nothing
fucking idiot.
He is nothing going loser. On here.
He's fucking dumb." Oh man! So the turtles come out of a sewer, and there's this amazing flip that Raphael does out of the sewer somehow.
Everyone's coming up head first, and he puts his head up, and then he brings his legs out to kick. Like,
brings his legs out, and then like tucks them back in, and then like explodes.
It does, like, a back bend. Yeah,
it's weird. Yeah,
I'm gonna put a screenshot for people who listen to the show and do follow us on Twitter. You'll see the screenshot and understand. But I'm telling you now, I'm not putting any description of what's happening on this screenshot. I'm just going to post it. It's going to say no context. You figure it out. And
it'll
be an inside joke between us.
Just hit upload and don't worry about it.
Okay. It'll just be us.
Infidel dogs.
Stop saying that.
You can't just yell that. Last time I did, I got arrested.
What?
No, well, to be fair,
I was wearing a t-shirt that said, "Well, if I had a gun, you'd be dead."
Oh, God.
Yeah, I don't.
Just said, fuck
America. That was just the shirt. I don't want to talk about the rest of the outfit, but I normally think the argument, like, it's because of what they were wearing is a little weak, but you got to admit, man, like, did you see what you were wearing before you came out?
It's a shirt from my other podcast.
Yeah, but it wasn't just
the shirt.
I was
wearing my own merch.
But why did you have the headdress?
It was traditional at that point. I can't yell infidel dogs and not have a headdress.
Why did you have the codpiece?
Codpiece?
Because, do you see how many times the cops kicked me in the nuts?
Yeah, but maybe if it wasn't for how dangerous the codpiece was, they wouldn't have attacked you.
Well, I mean, I got to protect myself, and then I also might as well make it a fashion statement and put spikes on it.
Why did you put electrical wires all over the outside of the vest?
I was doing a Tron thing. It was like
it
cosplay.
It makes it look like...
It looked like you had a bomb.
Like it. Well, I don't want to say that's racist, but it looks some sort of like some
honest.
Sort
How
of electronics.
How dare you infidel dog?
Oh, God, he has a bomb!
Oh, God, he's sitting in my house and relaxing. Get him!
He's coming right for us!
And scene.
Next scene.
So now we're actually rewatching the animation.
I'm done
where,
with the notes.
Where Shredder comes out and could actually destroy Bebop and Rocksteady.
Good dad.
He could do it now. He could do it
but
now.
He doesn't.
He now,
could kill, now.
Now.
While they're
now,
shooting.
Now.
He could do it now.
He's still
Raphael
doing it.
Raphael throws his ladder.
They're,
he's, knocks down Rocksteady.
They're
he
dead.
Could still stab him in the
he's
back of the
still
head.
Stabbing him.
Bebop is fighting Michelangelo and
now
winning.
He's,
he could protect his son.
He's turning them into cubes at this point.
He could make such good bacon out of Bebop.
Guys, we're on the same side. Look how I help you. By watching you get defeated.
Yeah.
God.
Bebop
such an
runs
idiot.
Into the manhole.
Uncovered
manhole.
Does April not have a zoom on her camcorder? Does she have to run after them?
She does.
Well, no. It was
her videotaping would make me sick.
Yeah, probably. This is before Blair Witch. We're not used to it yet.
Oh, fuck. Blair Witch.
It actually
what about
was
it?
Inspired by this show.
What do you mean inspired by?
Blair Witch was inspired by April O'Neil.
That's why those three kids decided to go out in the woods and fucking die?
Yeah.
For us?
For April O'Neil.
For us. For our sins.
They died for our sins in the woods.
That documentary's fucked up.
How fucked up would it be if they didn't actually switch bodies and when Leo was shaking Shredder's hand, he stabbed him in the face?
Oh, God.
It'd be fucked up, right?
You know what they should have done with Blair Witch?
Shit.
What?
Is not had the actors go on, like, talk shows to promote it.
Yeah, you're right.
But they got
maybe then
got
I would
Lee.
Have actually been scared of it.
Yeah, they wanted to make more money.
They wanted to be in the limelight.
Yeah.
Whereas, yeah, if you were really to be authentic about it, it's like, no, don't. Well, I doubt
the actors are the ones that chose to go on those shows. I'm sure the producer
or their agents.
Well, I'm pretty sure those rights are owned by the studio, and they're the ones that make them.
Didn't they have a marketing campaign where the actors were not anywhere to be found for a while or something?
In the beginning, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
But then as the movie came out, then they started
got more popular.
They were called Regis and Kathy Lee.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Because, yeah, when it first came out, there was seriously people who were is this real? Is this,
There were, my God. News articles and stuff like that.
Yeah, yeah, people really, and I, I'm sure part of that was publicity stunts, but.
Bassem. Can we reenact one of my favorite parts? Bassem, where'd you put the map?
Side note to the audience, I've never seen Blair Witch Song.
Okay, never mind. You improvised, but you asked me where I put the map. We've been lost in the woods for 3 days.
Yeah, I know.
And we've been walking around in circles.
Well, and where'd you put the map?
Oh, I threw it in the river.
Why would you throw the map in the river?
Because fuck it. It wasn't helping us anyway.
Well, I've never seen that map. And I feel like if I had a chance to look at it, maybe we could get out of
it. Yeah, I threw it in the fucking river.
Do you remember where the river was? Because we could follow the river?
Well, we've been following the river, but we keep going in big fucking circles.
How does that happen?
I don't know.
Is the river actually a lake?
I feel like we could consult the map, but I threw it out. I threw it in the river.
Hmm.
Yeah, so it's gone.
Well.
And then this is the part where you get very upset.
I am upset.
Yeah.
Blindingly so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Enraged. Really?
That's when they start screaming, and there's a lot of fuck, 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 fuck.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
I just threw it in the river. It wasn't helping us, so I just threw it in the river.
I'm upset at that.
I made that choice myself.
Without consulting me.
Or the other woman that's here, because there's three of us.
Oh, shit, where did you come from?
She's been here the
whole
time.
I've been here the whole time.
Yeah.
You didn't...
She's the other camera person.
Technically, you're the woman... Because she was the one that got really upset about the map.
Oh, yeah.
Dare you, you infidel
dog. I'm sorry.
Dog.
It's been a really long time since I've seen this movie, so I'm watching this scene.
I just remember that part, which was a really good part.
Huh.
It was, and it was you could genuinely get angry. You really were that guy is a fucking idiot. I would strangle him.
Well, what's great is that I just disappear in the middle of the night.
So that solves that.
We go to sleep in a tent, and then you wake up, and I'm gone. And then the next night... you find this bundle wrapped with sticks and cotton.
Uh-huh.
And when you open it up, you find all of my teeth.
Oh, good. How do I know it's your teeth?
You don't.
Oh. I just assume?
Well, yeah.
Well, I think that makes sense.
Because there's a Blair Witch. You know about the Blair Witch.
What's a Blair Witch? Why is it called the Blair Witch?
That's what they call it.
Why, though?
Because it's a fake urban legend, and that's just what they call it.
Yeah. Is it? Oh. But it wasn't
it killed kids,
in Blair City or something like that?
No?
I don't know.
Was it?
I don't know. I'm asking you. I never seen the movie.
It was in the woods.
Urban legends are
the Blair Woods? That's what I'm asking. Where did that name Blair come from?
I feel like this is blaringly obvious.
The Tony Blair.
All right, we're hitting an hour 20 here.
Jesus. All right. Okay.
I'm ready.
Here we go.
Everyone should be dead.
Guess what, guys?
They have a plan. They are gonna go back and pretend that they found Shredder and that they're gonna that they don't know that Splinter.
You're doing your lightning
really
recap
Shredder.
Voice.
Tell you what, why don't we just pizza power it and do a lightning recap?
Yeah, I'm
fuck,
fine
pizza
with that.
Pizza power.
Pizza power. With comedians, lizards, and tadpoles, and on the edge of your mind, that there's something better than this. A better dream and a carrot. Maybe a seed from the parrot. Believe me when I tell you the word you're made of don't exist. But pizza power, a flying saucer food delight. Pizza power, oh, that's what makes us feel alright.
All right.
Bassem.
Same way we start every Pizza Power, let's ask Natalie for a lightning recap.
No! Like we do every time.
Okay. Every time.
Make sure you finish it.
This is your time to redeem it.
Because last time was awful.
Last time was bad, and I feel like you've had more than a week to to practice.
I'm gonna give. Are we ready?
Yeah.
Okay. Lightning recap.
Lightning recap.
Irma's crying about a man. It's disgusting. April gets a call. There's something happening at Central Tech a lot. And she brings a camera, and they're looking for a galvanometer, and they fuck it up, and the turtles arrive with Splinter, and they switch minds, and then they go back to each other's lairs, Splinter is mean and Shredder is nice, and everybody loses their minds, and then they try to trick each other, and then they lure them back to the original galvanometer and switch back and somehow the machine only works when you shoot it with a ray gun again, and everyone should be dead, and the building collapses and the world ends.
I don't remember a lot of that.
Oh, and there was a pizza machine.
Okay, yeah.
No, that's right.
Hey!
Well then.
Cranny, what do you think about the episode?
I don't know. I did not much care for it, to be honest.
Thank you. I hope you all liked my fantastic Cranny impersonation again.
So good.
Well, let's ask you for real. Cranston, what did you think about the episode?
And I hope you guys loved my BASP impression I just did.
Good job.
Thanks. All right, now actually ask me.
Cranston, did you think this was a good episode or a bad episode?
Jesus Christ, Natalie. I didn't know your BASM impression was that good.
Yeah.
I got skills.
She's been working
absolutely
on it.
God damn.
Natalie, what do you think Cranston's impression of the episode is?
I think he's going to say it was good.
BASM, that's amazing!
Not only was the impression great, but I also guessed your response.
Okay, let's stop fucking around here.
I am so confused.
Let's actually do it.
All right.
Okay. BASM.
Yes.
Good episode, bad episode.
Yeah, what'd you think?
I think it was a good episode.
Cowabunga!
Ding, 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 ding.
Don't do that. I'm trying to put in the sound clip.
There was a pause.
Barely.
Yeah.
Anyway, let me tell you why.
Okay.
Animation.
I'll allow it.
Was okay.
It was. Minus the side mouth.
The fight scenes were good and original compared to what we've seen before. It wasn't just this stupid tripping and bullshitty stuff. There was actually gunfire, actually use of the weapons, actually flipping and acrobatics. I liked the fight scenes, both of them, even though they ended silly. The plot was okay. The Irma thing was done at the beginning, so it didn't matter. And the plot was singular and focused enough. So I was happy with it. Natalie, do you think this was a good episode or a bad episode?
I would agree. I would say that it was a good episode.
Cowabunga!
Why?
Yes, it begin. I'm getting there.
For why?
Yes, it begins horribly. I hate the beginning scene. It's stupid. Irma's stupid. Fuck off. But then, yeah, like, I think it's
harsh.
Focused. Well, it, you know, she's a shittily written character. I don't care.
Ooh. Cutting deep.
But yeah, I think I agree with BASM. It's focused. I think that there's actually some clever plan making. You kind of get to be in Splinter's head, which I think he's probably the smartest of anybody on the show. So yeah, I enjoyed it.
Great.
I forgot to mention, there's during this time they're kind of talking in their heads, like you said. Mm-hmm. But there's one scene where Shredder, who's in Splinter's body, is making a plan with himself, but they animated his mouth moving.
He's thinking
it was
out
weird.
Loud.
He's
monologue.
Thinking out loud, but his voice is Shredder's voice.
Like, we know that they record the voices first.
We're pretty sure.
Well, that's usually how it's done. So it was very peculiar. Like, there's some sort of disconnect somewhere between the writing
and
the direction.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't know where that is.
I think it's big. I think it's because they outsource the
animation.
Someone
like to ask me my...
Yes.
For the fourth fucking time, Cranston.
No, those were all impressions.
Do you think this was a good
Don't
episode of Ninja
illusion.
Turtles, or do you think this was a bad episode of Ninja Turtles?
Bad episode.
Oh, shell shock.
Why?
I cannot agree with you guys that... Okay, the plot was more straightforward than I was expecting. I'll give you that. But I feel like they threw in some weird tropes there. Like, from the get-go, Splinter going with them on a mission because Leo has a bruised arm
That is the one
it part doesn't make...
that I concede was too coincidental or too shittily
contrived.
Like, they fight people all the time.
Yeah.
Like, they get the shit kicked out of them, but he gets hit with a little thing in his arm, and he has a bruise, and Splinter's like, I will accompany you on your mission.
He's just looking for an excuse. He's just getting antsy.
Well, the writers are looking for an excuse to get him into this brain swap thing, because I can't think of anything better.
Yeah. Okay. Well, let me ask you a little bonus question then.
Love
was
it.
The how is this episode compared to Sky Turtles?
Oh, shit.
Better. I think this is a much better episode than Sky Turtles.
No, Sky Turtles was great.
No, Sky Turtles was like so far-fetched I couldn't even get behind it.
Yeah, but it was so bad that at least entertained me more.
It's awful.
Sometimes that's the case, yeah. I feel like mood's more difficult too. I don't know. I'm more tired. Maybe I'm it's harder for me to just relax and enjoy it.
It's okay.
I feel like I enjoyed this.
It's a possibility.
Good. Let's do some episode stats.
How many cowabungas?
We had 0 cowabungas.
How many pizzas?
0 pizzas.
But
2 fourth wall breaks.
Yes.
Which brings our total cowabungas.
That's a 1/8 wall break.
Yes. No, for it's a half wall break.
Oh shit!
When you add, when you add fractions.
Oh, fourth wall.
Yeah.
1/4. 1/4 is 2/4. 1/2.
Yeah.
Half wall break.
Yeah.
For you kids at home.
That brings our total to 27 cowabungas. 17 fourth wall breaks.
You should update the thing.
And
it's... Wow.
Freezing.
Saved.
All right, good. That was weird.
Wow, my computer is so fucking... I'm glad I spent all that money on it.
I had 2 power surges while I was recording Wiki How We Do It last week.
Oh, weird.
And luckily, Audacity saved the audio, even though I... Like, you know, we don't save the Audacity file at all.
Do you have a good surge protector?
Yeah.
Good. You get one of those battery backups.
He's a shout-out to Audacity.
Shout-out to Aud!
Absolutely shout-out to Audacity. Thanks for giving us free, great software to record this shit with.
Yep. Yes. Let me read some pizzas. So, on the menu, we have Living Meatball Pizza, anchovies smothered in gazai leaves, anchovies, granola and licorice. And then coming up, we have peanut butter and pickles, meatball and vanilla ice cream, anchovies and butterscotch ice cream, chocolate fudge ice cream with extra garlic, and chocolate sprinkles pizza. Woo!
Woo!
We have an email.
Oh.
Yes.
From who?
We have an email from Casey.
Your Casey?
Yes. Let me give you a little background.
Okay.
The other day, I came home. It was Casey's day off. She decided to get a little tipsy. And that's, like I said, it's okay. But she started writing iTunes reviews and writing emails while being tipsy. So.
Okay.
I mean, I don't think this would really come off across as a drunk person writing it, but I just think it's funny.
Can you hear it? Like, when you read it?
I can a little bit.
Can you kind of tell?
A little bit. Let me read it to you. Dear, so the title is, the subject is, I do, pick me.
Okay.
Okay. Dear Stephen Cranston Jr.
Okay, this is to me.
Accurate.
I would like to have my own song.
What?
Listen. I have been listening to you and Bassam since you both had the U-tube Chanel. Spelled Chanel. I made Tanabata Day my ringtone.
Oh, yeah.
Four exclamation points.
For those who don't know, we played... What's the name of that game?
It was a pigeon...
It's a pigeon dating sim.
I can't remember the name. It's a pigeon dating sim. And they talk about Tanabata Day, which I guess is this actual thing in Japan.
It's a festival where
we
put
didn't
your wish on a bamboo tree or whatever.
We didn't actually know what it was.
Correct.
So I just started singing a song about it.
I was
off
reading
the
words, and he just busts out into song.
Yeah, and half the lyrics are just like straight from the what was displayed on
the
screen.
I'm gonna put it in here.
Go ahead.
Tanabata?
What the fuck is that?
It's Tanabata Day.
There's probably a bamboo tree.
Okay. There's a bamboo tree in the plaza. We go and make a wish. And then with the wish you get a Tanabata.
You obviously know all about this culture.
I even know the song.
Wow, that sure was magical.
Yeah. So anyway, she continues. Since listening to TMNT podcast, I don't think she knows what our show is called.
It is not called TMNT podcast.
I have yet to hear a comparable song, .. until now, all caps. I can't get Natalie Cowboys out of my head.
Which one is that?
From last episode.
I don't even remember Natalie Cowboys.
You said you would make a song for anyone. I said demo it on Natalie. She said, I like cowboys.
Wasn't that in response, like, that'd be a Patreon reward?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
So, right. Natalie Cowboys is what she loves. She can't get Natalie Cowboys out of her head, which is true. She's been walking around singing, going, Natalie Cowboys, you suck the dick.
Okay.
She says,
Steven, you are a songsmith.
Yeah.
I guess.
We're not worthy.
Best, move over, Jack Black.
Best original cranny I've heard yet.
Wow.
3 exclamation points.
That's very nice.
She asks, what do you need from me so that I can have my own, random apostrophe, original cranny theme song?
We just need a prompt, I guess.
What's her end game here? What is she
wants
really
to have a new ringtone. That's customized to her from you singing about her, I guess.
So this is a song that would happen when
her phone rings.
She picked the wrong week for me to sing a song off the top of my head.
You just gotta feel what's
because
in your
soul. I am tired and irritable, as we've discussed a few
just
times.
Just sing about
what's
Casey.
What's something that Casey likes?
Give me a subject here, Bassam. So if it's bad, it's your fault.
Does she like squirrels?
Does she like squirrels?
Like astronauts?
Astronauts.
Repetition.
Yeah.
You know, I think she just likes something catchy. If we have to think about a subject matter, she's been rewatching a lot of 6 Feet Under lately.
Perfect.
And
do you know anything about 6 Feet Under, Steven?
Can work with that.
We've also been rewatching Firefly so that Mimo can see it because he's never seen it.
Oh, that's one of my favorites.
Yeah.
That's a good one.
She likes our cat, Callisto. She likes sleeping with her head in the closet.
Wait, the cat?
Casey?
The cat gets into Casey's closet. No, listen. The cat gets into Casey's closet.
I thought you were talking about Casey.
No, I am. She wraps herself up in, like, on top of Casey's, like, shoes in the closet. Casey, in the morning, when she doesn't have to get up early, she'll open the door, lay on the ground, and, like, sleep with her head on the cat in the closet. So if you come in the room, you just see Casey in the closet. It looks like she, like, fainted
Casey,
or something.
Casey, I love you so much. I'm crying.
It's pretty comfortable, though.
Let me see if I can throw something out.
Okay. We need silence for one take, Cranston.
Using all of the information that's just been given to me, I present to you, Casey, a song about you. Is that what she wants? It's about her, right?
Yeah, and something that'll be okay enough to put as a ringtone, too. Okay. So, like, not super filthy.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm Casey. I'm not a human. I'm Casey. I'm an android. I'm Casey. Oh, God, I'm a bum.
What? We talked about neither bums or androids in the last day.
Wait, what did you guys say?
Cats.
That was like the meanest thing you could say about her.
What? The meanest thing?
She's
that's not the meanest thing.
You're an android bum.
It's just
it's
absurd.
Pretty awful.
It's absurd. It's not rude. Is that rude?
No, no one actually thinks Casey is a bum.
No.
Though I bet her bum looks really cute when she's
that'd be a great sci-fi story.
Closet with her cat.
I'll try one more.
All right, okay. One more. Yeah.
Oh, man. I'm not built for it today.
Do you want to redo it next week? Try again?
Yes.
Okay, fair enough.
He's going to think about it for a week.
And by that, I mean I'll have better improv when they bring it up next week.
Yeah. I won't think about it at all until Batson brings it back up.
I probably won't.
Yeah. Oh, fuck. We had to talk about this. I forgot.
Oh, shit.
Sitting in the closet with your cat, with your bum in your air. It's so cute with your bum in the air. I'm going to take you home and put you in the closet.
That was way better.
I'm going to lock you up, put you in my emotional closet. You can scream, but no one will come.
I want you to scream. Oh,
so God. I can come.
Stop. It's so dark.
I'm going to lock you in my emotional closet.
No one can hear you scream. Yeah, it was dark.
I'm gonna wrap you up in self-loathing.
Wrap you up so you can't go.
Hey, how can the world contact you?
Okay, let's talk about things. The ways to talk to us. If you want to talk to us.
I thought there was another email.
Nope.
Oh. I was literally just killing Casey. Time because I thought you said you had another email.
I thought I may have too.
Nope.
It's all right.
Okay.
False alarm.
If you want to reach us, you can contact us on Twitter at TurtlePowerPod. If you want to email us like Casey did.
We have an email.
TurtlePowerPod@gmail.com.
We have a Facebook.
Facebook.com/TurtlePowerPod.
We have a YouTube.
The link is in the description of this show.
It's Bassam and Cranny YouTube.
You can search Bassam and Cranny and you'll find us.
Yeah.
It's not a simple link. That's the only issue.
But we don't have to link right to the episode, just where they can find us.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's super easy to
You don't have to make
them.
It harder than it needs to be.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
We should make it harder.
The link is youtube.com/channel/user/XV M. Like, it's all fucked up, man. That's what I'm saying.
It's all fucked up, man.
Just search Bassam and Cranny.
Yes. If you want to, I'm going to plug my shit. Wiki How We Do It. It's my new podcast, son. It's on iTunes and on Stitcher. You can listen and have fun.
Wiki How We Do It.
Are we plugging this at the end of every episode now?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, comma, please. You can listen to the sweet-ass intro that is Cranston's voice. And then you can listen to me and my friend Sarah challenge each other to do silly shit.
Sarah was upset with me.
Oh, no.
Because of last episode.
Unseriously upset, yes.
No, seriously, unseriously upset.
Yes.
Upset at Steven or at me?
No, at me.
Steven.
Because he was plugging his show.
Mm-hmm.
My other podcast.
Yeah.
Wiki How We Do It. Wiki. With Sarah Banks.
.com. No.
And I interrupted by saying that Sarah and I were Facebook friends because I thought that was important to me.
And it's important to her, I'm sure.
Well, now I don't think it's very important.
Well, let me read you an actual text from Sarah.
I'm more spiteful.
Let me read you an actual text.
Do we have her consent to do this?
Whoa.
Tell her that if she wants us to plug your shitty podcast, she's going to have to give her goddamn
I'm consent. Super excited for next week's challenge.
No, I haven't heard it yet, but the premise is fucking hilarious.
Okay, good.
I mean, I've totally listened to it. It's great. You're my best friend.
She said.
And he quotes.
She said. It's like hurting cats. You said something about a wall, and he was like, uterine wall!
I said that?
Yeah.
That's how his brain works.
Yeah.
Why is that a compliment?
I didn't say it was a compliment.
I mean, why is...
I just said I was reading
a comment.
Text.
Yeah. Oh.
That's it.
Hurting cats. I guess it depends on what Sarah assumes the end goal of the podcast is.
Yeah.
I don't know what the end goal is.
Yeah, I don't think staying on topic isn't
part of the thing. Yeah.
That's true.
Uterine wall in that moment was probably funny.
Yeah. Probably.
It's not like he was trying to get me anywhere.
Wasn't I?
Were you?
Wasn't I?
That's some real talk.
Moroni?
Real talk, Cranston.
Where do you want me to go?
Mormon?
I want you to go where you need to go.
Do you need to go back to bed, Stephen?
Yes. Then I want you to go to there.
Bye.
Oh, shit. You dropped the mic.
Bye, everybody.
It's not very effective if you drop the mic onto the couch.
All right, everyone. Everyone, all together now. Turtle power.
Turtle power.
You will not get the last show.
Turtle pound her. Turtle pounder. Quarter pounder with cheese. Turtle power with cheese. These knees.
1, 2, 3. Turtle power.
Turtle power.
Fucking all of you. I hate you all. 1, 2, 3.
Turtle power.
Can I talk directly to the audience?
Yes.
Hello, audience. This is the part of the podcast where we try to say something extra to give you folks that listen after the credits a little something special. I don't know if it's because you're actually listening. I don't know if it's because you're on the toilet and it's too inconvenient to stop the podcast. Maybe you're in your car. I don't know. But what I would like to say to you is this.